So what we're going to do this morning is we're going to look at Christ, and we're going to look at his resurrection, and we're going to look at what he did, and specifically we're going to kind of ask a question that something I like to do is I like to look at things maybe from a different perspective. And I like to start with a question that will hopefully lead us to a deeper understanding of God's word. And so today we're going to look at the question, why doesn't the world see Jesus as the Messiah? Why can't the world see it? Why do Christians see it? Why do 33%, I guess, of all the religions in the world, we see Christ? We see what he did. We're here this morning, hopefully, because of that. So why can't the rest of the world see that Jesus is the Messiah? Did you know that this was actually prophesied 700 years before Jesus even walked on the earth, that it was prophesied that the rest of the world, they weren't going to see him, that it was going to be hard for everybody to kind of to recognize that he was the Messiah? And so that's what we're going to look at today. We're going to look at a passage of Scripture in Isaiah chapter 53. So if you have your Bible, if you turn to Isaiah 53, if you need a Bible, there should be one on the seat beside you or around you somewhere, a little blue one. Grab that. You know, as we get started, I'm a sucker for, this is going to sound, I mean, like most men, I'm a sucker for a good romantic comedy. Like most fellas, right? You guys identify. As I was reading through this passage of Scripture, a romantic comedy from, I think it's like the early 2000s, just popped into my head as being the perfect picture of the gospel of Jesus Christ. Not really, but I was thinking about this romantic comedy and just how it fits specifically with why the world doesn't see Jesus. Do you guys remember seeing the movie You've Got Mail? Okay, so great movie. It's one of a line of several movies that Tom Hanks and Meg Ryan did together. Well, this was a neat situation because Tom Hanks is the big, he's the corporate book owner. He's like your Barnes & Noble type guy. He's Barnes & Noble, right? And he's building this monstrous bookstore, and it's shutting down Meg Ryan's little around-the-corner bookstore. Well, this is happens all at the boom of internet and social media, email, and all those things. And so he somehow, through the internet, begins to build a relationship with this girl via email. And the girl just happens to be, unbeknownst to him, the girl that's he's shutting down her shop. And so as you go through the movie, you see this weird interaction. She sees him and hates him, and he's sarcastic to her, but online they're just in love with each other. Oh, you know, they're just talking and just kind of getting to know each other. Well, then there's this the critical point in the movie when the two are supposed to meet, right? And it's your classic, I'm going to be at the coffee shop and I'm going to have a red rose. You know, this is what she's saying. So when you show up, you'll know it's me. Well, as he shows up to the coffee shop, she's already in there. She's got her book out. She's got her coffee. She's got her rose on her little table. And as he's walking up, he looks into the window and he sees there's a red rose on the table. And as he looks up, he sees her, the woman that despises him, the woman that hates him. So this whole time, it clicks. The whole time, he's been emailing and chatting and falling in love online with the girl that hates him. So if he shows up and walks in and says, I'm the guy, it's going to be over. So in his heart, he quickly devises a plan. He shows up, he walks in, and she didn't want to have anything. She's like, get away, I'm meeting somebody, get out of here, what are you doing? And he just kind of says, look, let's start over. Let's see, I'm not as bad of a guy as maybe you think I am. And he says, let's just start over. Give me a chance. I'll prove to you that I'm not the guy you think I am. And so the whole rest of the movie is all about him trying to show that he is really this great guy without telling her that he's the one that they've been talking about online, right? And at the end of the movie, spoiler alert, if you haven't seen this 2001 rom-com, I'm not really sad for you. But in the end, walking through Central Park, he's got the rose, she gets it, tears, oh, they hug, they kiss, and they live happily ever after. Have 15 kids and grandkids, and it's amazing, right? Well, the reason I say that that movie fits perfectly with this situation is that we come to Christ, and we want Him to be a certain way. We want Jesus to be this person that we want Him to be. We want to see Him the way we want Him to be in a worldly fashion, but He doesn't come that way. He comes differently. The Bible says that it's you know, when Jesus goes to His disciples and He turns to them and He says, "Who does the world say I am?" They give Him this great picture of, they want to see everybody but the Messiah. It'll be on your screen. This is found in Matthew chapter 16, verse 13 through 16. Now, when Jesus came into the district of Caesarea Philippi, He was asking His disciples, "Who do the people say that the Son of Man is?" And they said to Him, "Some say John the Baptist, and others Elijah, but still others, even Jeremiah." So they look at Him as He's a good man, He's possibly a prophet, He's possibly somebody sent by God. But why couldn't they just say, "Yeah, everybody, everywhere, you're the Messiah"? Why didn't they say that? Because Jesus didn't look that way, right? He didn't come like that. And then look what Jesus asks. He said to them, "But who do you say that I am?" And then Simon Peter chimes in. Tough guy, Simon Peter. He gets it. "You are the Christ. You're the Son of the living God." The word Christ in Greek is Messiah. He says, "You're the one that was to be sent by God. You're the one that the prophets and all the Old Testament prophecies are prophesying about. You're Him." And he gets it. So how come the rest of the world just wants to see Jesus as a good man, as this great teacher? How come the world doesn't want to see Him as Messiah? Well, Isaiah prophesied about this. And that's what we're going to look at today. If you look at your Bible, chapter 52 of Isaiah, Isaiah comes into, he talks about this Messiah, and he's been talking about Him and hinting at who this guy's going to be all through his book. I mean, he writes a very extensive work on who the Messiah is going to be, Isaiah. I mean, his book is huge, and it's full of good stuff. And as he's talking and giving more details about who the Messiah is going to be, he comes to this section of Scripture where the Messiah all of a sudden changes. He doesn't look like this conquering king, like this guy who's supposed to come and establish the kingdom of God on earth forever and ever in the lineage of David, right? Because that's what everybody wanted. And he starts in 52 to say, yeah, he's going to be a servant. And not only is he going to be a servant, but he's going to come and he's going to be tortured. He's going to be punished. And something's going to happen to him. He specifically uses the word marred. Like he's going to get hurt so bad, he's going to get scarred up. And then when you get to chapter 53, verse 1, Israel, the people of Israel, you hear now speaking back to this prophecy. Look at verse 1 of chapter 53. It says, "Who has believed our message? And to whom has the arm of the Lord been revealed?" Now, chapter 52, verse 10, he talks about the strength of God. This arm of the Lord is going to be revealed, and he's going to use his strength. He's going to reveal it to all men, and he's going to use his strength to save the world. That's what chapter 52, the end of it's talking about, is the salvation that comes through the Messiah. But it's not going to just be this king showing up on the earth, establishing his reign, killing off the Romans, exalting the Jews and everybody living in harmony. It wasn't supposed to be that way. Did you realize that if Jesus came and established his kingdom at his first coming, that it would be a kingdom for him and the Jews only? There was this big national disparity between the Jews and the Gentiles. And Christ came that the world might know him, fulfilling the covenant with Abraham, fulfilling the Old Testament's prophecy about him saving the world. And so for the Jews, they were supposed to see the Messiah, but he was going to look a little different. He wasn't just going to be this coming king. And they asked the question, "Who are you telling this to? Because we have all the prophecies. We know what he's supposed to look like. And your prophecy, it doesn't quite look right." And then they start to explain things a little bit. So look at verse 2. What we're going to see now in the next 9 verses is the misconceptions about Jesus Christ. So I want to expose what the world thinks or gives us reasons why they don't want Jesus as a Messiah. So misconception number one is this. Because Jesus doesn't look like a Messiah, because he doesn't look like a king, he must not be a king. Right? That's classic. He doesn't look the part. He doesn't look like somebody that we would recognize. Because of his humiliation, because of Jesus' humiliation, he must not be this exalted king. He must just be some crazy dude who died in Israel 2,000 years ago. And he couldn't have risen from the dead because kings don't die like that, right? He didn't look like a king. He must not be a king. That's the idea. It's your classic Superman situation. How come nobody in all of, what was that, Metropolis, Gotham City? Where was Superman? Metropolis? Okay. In all of Metropolis, not a single person recognized that dude flying around just didn't have his glasses on. And that's kind of the situation we have here. Undercover Boss. Have you ever watched that show? They put glasses and a mustache on the dude, and now nobody knows who he is. Right? They should be able to see him. Just because he doesn't look the way you think he should doesn't mean that he doesn't look the way God meant him to look. Okay, so look at verse 2. He says, "For he, the Messiah, grew up before him, God, like a tender shoot, like a root out of the parched ground." This is a description that this guy is going to come up in a specific time going to be conducive to seeing him as the Messiah. He's going to be an unwanted little shoot. You ever have a root that comes up close to the ground from a tree in your yard or something, and sprigs of little shoots come up? You got a crepe myrtle in your yard and you chop it around the base and all these little shoots come shooting up. And that's kind of what it is. He's this unwanted little shoot to Israel. In other words, they're going to look at him and go, "You're that doesn't look right. Coming out of this parched ground." Keep looking. "He has no stately form or majesty that we should look upon him." In other words, the Messiah will not look like a king. He's not going to have this stately, majestic, political look to him when he first comes. He's not going to look like what you think he's going to look like. Keep reading. "He has nor his appearance that we should be attracted to him." Do you remember when in the Bible when Israel wanted a king, and so God gave them Saul, who was this tall, strapping, strong, big guy. And then he falls away from the Lord. And God says, "I'm going to go get another king. I'm going to get the king I want, not the king you want." And who does he go and get? He gets David. Now, did David look like a king? Now, David looked like a shepherd. As a matter of fact, Samuel goes to Jesse and he says, "Go get your boys because God has brought me here. One of your sons is going to be king." And who does he pick? Does he pick the oldest? He picked the strongest? He picked the guy who's got the best hair? The best looking skin? No, he picks the youngest, the weakest, the guy who gets all the junk jobs, right? That's just, David's out with the sheep right now while everybody else is having lunch, right? He picks that guy because he doesn't have a stately appearance. He doesn't have a majestic form, and yet he is going to be my king. You see, there might be a connection here that David might be a type of this Messiah guy, right? Keep reading with me. "We weren't necessarily supposed to be attracted to him." Look in verse 3. "He was despised and forsaken by men." It's amazing. John 7 verse 5 talks specifically about how even Jesus' brothers, before his resurrection, would not trust in him and they thought he was crazy. Even the guys close to him wouldn't acknowledge him, but they forsook him. Even his brothers. "He was despised by men. He was a man of sorrow and he was acquainted with grief. And like one to whom men hide their face, he is despised, and we did not esteem him. The word grief here means that he was acquainted with suffering. And Jesus was every much a man as you or I. The difference is he was every much God as we are not, right? So there's this idea that, in other words, Jesus, the world is going to see him not as king, but they're going to see him as despicable. They're not going to esteem him. They're going to see him as beneath consideration. He's worthless to us. Why? Because he doesn't look like a king. So here's the liberating truth for this, okay? As we just got through reading, as Isaiah is prophesying this, the truth that we pull out is this, that Jesus didn't look like the Messiah because man's concepts of the Messiah were wrong. Let's start right there. Their concepts of the Messiah were wrong. They had partial understanding. Is Jesus going to establish a kingdom? Yes, he is. Is he going to come with might and power and judge the earth? Yes, he is. Could he have done that before this moment of his coming and dying for the sins of mankind? He could not, because it would just have been him and the Jews, and the prophecies that he had prophesied, the covenants that he had made with Israel past would not have come to fulfillment, that he would be a blessing to the world, that he would save the world, that all the nations would come under him. That required him to taking away a barrier called sin, that he would come. So the reason he didn't look like a king is because the concepts that we brought into that picture were not kingly. You ever bought anything on Craigslist? And you tell them, we want to go to this, I'm going to meet you in the Walmart parking lot and we're going to exchange, you know. You don't ever, by the way, don't ever let them come to your house. Be smart. People get killed that way. So you meet them in the parking lot, and what do? You say, I'm going to be the guy in the blue Ford pickup. And you show up and there's 20 blue Ford pickups, right? You're like, so if you don't have his number, you drive around like, and you look like you're trying to pick people up in the Walmart parking lot, right? So what if they give it a little more specific and they say, yes, I'm going to be in a blue Ford pickup, but I'm going to be the guy in the blue suit. I'm going to be wearing a blue suit. Now here's how this works. Just like Israel, God gave them all the information, but they twisted it. Let's pretend like the guy says, I'm going to be the guy in the blue suit. And you go, oh, my dad wears a blue suit every day to work. This guy probably looks a lot like my dad. He looks a lot like me. My dad's a tall guy. Sorry, Dad, you're not that tall. But like, let's pretend. My dad's like 6'5", and you know, he's got this beautiful long mane. Whatever you're not, I'm just going to say it, okay? You know, and he's handsome. So you got this picture in your head, right? And you show up, and there's a couple of guys in blue suits, but you don't see them because they don't look like your father, because you think the guy should look like the person in your mind that you have reference of. So the Jews had all this reference of what an earthly king should be. And they thought the Messiah was supposed to look like that guy. And God had another plan. He wasn't going to look like that guy. The Bible says in 1 Corinthians that the message of the cross, the gospel of Jesus Christ, is foolishness to those who are perishing. In other words, the people who don't want to see Jesus are not going to see Jesus. No matter how much prophecy we pour out here, no matter how we beg and plead, if you don't want to see the Messiah, if your heart is not bent to having your sin taken away from you, then you're not going to see him. This is for us who are being saved. What is the gospel? It's the power of God to do something miraculous in my heart that I could have never done. I could have never done enough good works. I could have never pleased God in any other way. I had to have a miracle, and that miracle was Christ dying and raising from the dead. Isn't that amazing? All right, let's look at the second misconception. So the first one is that Jesus just didn't look like a king. He didn't look like the Messiah. But the second one is Jesus, because Jesus was punished like a criminal, he must have been a criminal. I mean, the Romans were, they had a pretty good system of government. You got to think, they ruled the earth for over 500 years. And I say the earth because all known civilization was ruled by them. They had a vast, extensive government. And so if they punished him, it must have been because he was broken somehow. He was a sinner. He did bad things. Because you don't just kill a man. Matter of fact, Paul even, he pointed this out. The Jews at one point flogged Paul. They beat him in a way that they weren't supposed to. And then when they found out that he was a Roman citizen, they were letting him go, begging him to shut up. Don't tell anybody that we did this, because we will get in serious trouble. So if Jesus got killed like a criminal, it was probably because he was one. All right? So let's look at the text. Look at verse 4. Surely our griefs, in other words, the word griefs here, again, afflictions or sufferings, our griefs he bore himself, and our sorrows he carried. Okay, so what he's doing here, what Isaiah's saying is that this guy is going to, something's going to happen to him, but it's not going to be because he's a criminal. It's going to be because we are criminals. Woo! He bore our sorrows, our sin. Okay, keep going with me. Yet we ourselves esteem him stricken, smitten of God, and afflicted. You know the word stricken here? This is a biblical word for when God did something to somebody. When God showed up and gave somebody leprosy because of their sin, they were stricken by God. So we see him as smitten, as stricken by God. He must have done something wrong because look what happened to him. Like, that doesn't happen to people who are good. That happens to people who God judges somehow for their sin. So even though he's bearing our sins on the cross, he's suffering for us, we're going to look at him and go, well, he died like a criminal. Must be a criminal. Keep reading with me. Verse 5, it says, but he was pierced through for our transgressions. I highlighted that section of text, right? He was pierced through. How was he pierced through? Amazing. 700 years prior to, he was pierced through his hands. He was pierced through his feet. He was stabbed with a spear in his side. He was pierced through for our transgressions. The word transgressions here is the word for sin. And notice it says he was crushed for our iniquities. The Hebrew word is avon. Specifically means guilt or depravity. He was crushed. God crushed him for your sin and my sin, for our guilt. He's paying for our guilt. When I said criminals earlier, that's exactly what I meant. We are criminals to God. No matter how good you look, no matter the fact that you haven't broken the law in, you know, at least a week, you and I are the criminals, right? So keep going with me. He says, the chastening of our well-being. Our well-being would mean the idea that for us to take away our guilt punishment, he died, or he suffered for us. And we receive the well-being of not being punished for our guilt, right? That's what he means. So the chastening of our well-being, it fell upon him. And by his scourging, we are healed. The stripes that Jesus took, the scourging, the beating, that fell on him, and that was supposed to fall on us. Man, aren't you glad? I'm going to stop for a second. I'm really glad. I do not want to have a beating by God. It was bad enough as a child. Can I just tell you about the beatings I received as a child? I'm just kidding. Can you imagine as an adult getting a spanking by God? Oh, praise God it fell on Jesus. Now, I don't want to sit there and watch it happen, but I'm so glad it happened. It says, all we like sheep have gone astray. I love this because now he's explaining why this all happened. Why did the Messiah pay for the sins, our sins? What do you mean? Why would he do that? It's because we are like sheep and we wander off. We wander off. Don't raise your hand. But I'm going to ask you a question. Do you wander off? So don't nod your head either. Oh, okay, I know. Yeah. We all do, right? If I say, are you struggling with something right now that God would be less than pleased with in your life? All of us, every criminal in this room would go, yep. I'm not going to tell you about it. I'm not going to expose it to you. But I'll nod my head at you. Right? All we like sheep have gone astray. Each of us has turned not to the way of God, not to the way of righteousness, but to our own way, which is the way of self. Do you guys realize that self is the God, or it is the idol that we worship as humans? It's self. It's me. I worship myself. What I want, I do. What I want, I get. It's me. I'm not conforming to God, but conforming to myself. That's because I'm a sheep, and I wander away to my own direction and my own devices, right? But notice what happens. But the Lord has caused our iniquity, the iniquity of us all, the guilt of us all, to fall on Him. So wait. So He's not the problem. He's not the criminal. We are. So the liberating truth for this is that Jesus wasn't punished for being a criminal. He was punished in the place of the criminals, .. i.e. you and me. Humbling, right? That's not fun. Happy Easter! Let's go eat. The Bible says in Romans 5:8, it says, but God demonstrated His own love towards us in that while we were all sinners, Christ died for us. Amen. Hallelujah. Now we can go eat. So that's the second misconception. Here's the third. Isaiah keeps going. There's one more. This misconception is that, well, because Jesus didn't defend Himself, like all normal people do, He must not be innocent. Because when He was put to the cross, He didn't say, whoa, what are you doing? He didn't fight back. He didn't gripe and moan and throw a fit and call in all of His witnesses. No, I've got thousands of people. Bring in everybody I healed. Bring in everybody I healed right now. You guys want to put me to death? Let's get it on. You know, I'd just be a fiery mess. Scorched earth. Jesus alone standing, dripping with sweat and dirt. Like a perfect action movie ending where He kills everybody. No, He didn't fight because of something else. Not because He was a criminal. Look at the text. This is found, look at verse 7 of Isaiah 53. It says, He was oppressed and He was afflicted, yet He did not open His mouth. In other words, this was planned. This was on purpose. He did this for a reason. Like a lamb that is led to the slaughter, and like a sheep that is silent before his shearers, so He did not open His mouth. It's interesting, Matthew 27 describes this incredible interaction, but it's this kind of final interaction where Jesus had, He's in His sixth trial, and He's standing before Pilate, the governor, the guy who has the power to swoop, drop the axe. And Pilate is trying to have this discussion with Him. And Jesus is not really playing. And then Pilate finally asks Him a question He can answer. Because all the time they've been asking Him questions like, what do you got to say about these charges that they bring against you? That you are inciting a riot? That you that you want to throw down the government of Rome? What are you going to say about these things? And He wouldn't play. He didn't play. But then Pilate asks Him a question. He says, are you the King of the Jews? And He says, I can answer that one. It is as you say. And then Pilate goes, well, why don't you say something about all this other stuff? And Jesus goes, whoop, and He gets quiet again. Because he's not going to try to defend Himself against that, because He has something else He's doing here. He's got something else going on. Look at the text. Verse 8. By oppression and judgment He was taken away, and He was cut off out of the land of the living for the transgression of My people. This concept of being cut off means that He was killed. You see this in Daniel. Daniel prophesies about that, that ultimately the Messiah will come and he'll be cut off from the land of the living. He was cut off for our transgressions of the people to whom the stroke was due. It says no one realized that Jesus was there to give them life. Keep reading with me. Look in verse 9. His grave was assigned with wicked men. In other words, he was killed like a criminal. He was put up between two criminals. He was placed in a tomb that was guarded by Roman soldiers, and they placed a seal across the stone that was placed to cover the tomb and to keep the smell and the decay in. They sealed it. Who do you do that for except criminals, right? But yet he was with a rich man at his death. Joseph of Arimathea pleaded for the body of Christ. Joseph of Arimathea was a member of the Sanhedrin. And he pleaded. He was humble enough to step away from those guys and go, I want Jesus. I want his body. This should not be taking place. I separate myself. Give me Jesus. He's a rich man. So he's with a rich man at his death because he had done no violence, nor was there any deceit in his mouth. Jesus was innocent. He was sinless, just like he was supposed to be. So the liberating truth is Jesus didn't defend himself because of his love for us. I want you to put yourself in this position, okay? I'm going to play out a scenario real quick. So let's pretend like you are going to jail for something you didn't do. All right, so if that was the case, if it were me, and I was being accused of something, I would defend myself, right? If I was going to go to jail for something I didn't do, I would be calling all my witnesses. I would be trying to get out of it. I'd be thinking of my family. I'd be thinking of my friends. I'd be thinking of who's going to take care of them. I have to fight this. I have to be here for them. But there's a scenario where I could be accused of something I didn't do and not fight back. There is a scenario. You want to know what that scenario is? If my daughter or son had committed that crime, I wouldn't fight back. Would you? Depends on the day, right? But if my daughter or son had committed the crime that I was being accused of, and I knew that if I threw a fit, well, then they were going to be exposed and that they were going to be punished for their sin, you know what? I might not fight back. You know what? I might just go and be silent. And when they said, all of the evidence is stacked against you, don't you have anything to say for yourself? I probably wouldn't say anything. I'd be like, nope, let's get this over with. Y'all are wasting taxpayer money. Let's do this. Lock me up. If I was doing it for someone I loved, right? For someone I loved. And that's the liberating truth. He wasn't punished like a criminal. He was punished in the place of the criminals. So now we have our three misconceptions. I want to share this little piece of scripture before we move on to the last piece of text. I want you to really think about this. This is found in John. It says, greater love has no man than what? He who lays down his life for his friends. Jesus said that. He said that about to his disciples about how to live, and then right after he said that, he modeled it for us. So now let's take a little different approach to this. So now in the text, Isaiah, or you see the people talking about, notice God has not been talking at this point. These were not prophecies of the Lord to man. This was the people speaking out of what this guy was going to look like and why people weren't going to get it. Who's going to believe this? Who has God revealed his strength to? Because this is what you're saying. All of these things don't look like the Messiah we've been talking about. Doesn't look like the Messiah. He's going to be punished like a criminal. He can't be innocent. So who are you talking to? Now the Lord speaks in the text. Look at verse 10. We're going to answer this question. So what happens to those who do trust in this guy? See, Israel's saying, How can we trust in this guy? How can we believe this? Because this looks so different. He says, but you know what? Those who do, let me show you. There's three verses. The first thing that's going to happen, for those who do, they're going to have their sins taken away. For those who trust in this guy, they're going to have their sins removed. Look at the text. Look at verse 10. It says, but the Lord was pleased. In other words, this was a part of his will. It wasn't that God was happy. Ah, Jesus and the cross. Yeah. It wasn't that kind of pleased. It was, this was a part of his will. He had thought about this since before you and I had come to be on this earth. This was a part of his foreknowledge, a part of his plan. Look what he says. He was pleased to crush him, to put him to grief, suffer. If he rendered himself as a guilt offering, in other words, as an offering to take away guilt, an offering to take away sin, this is what the Jewish priests would do. They would take an offering or a lamb, a bull, dove, and they would take it and they would kill it and they would take its blood and they would sprinkle it as a guilt offering to take away the guilt of the people. All right? He says, if he would offer himself as a guilt offering, notice what's going to happen. He will see his offspring and he will prolong his days. In other words, if he goes through this process and he takes away the sins of the world, he's going to live again. He's going to prolong his days. How does a person, after they have been cut off from the living, prolong his days? You know how they do that? They raise from the dead. That's how they do it. It says he'll see his offspring. In other words, he's, because of this, he's going to have a myriad of children, of which I hope we are all sitting here together, children of the Messiah, right? He's going to see his offspring. He's not going to stay dead. He's going to live again. And the good pleasure of the Lord will prosper in his hand. So the thing that's going to happen is that our guilt is going to be taken away. The second thing that's going to happen for all of us who trust in this guy, look at verse 11, is the God's wrath, his holiness demands a holy payment. So when we screw up, I'm sorry. He's a holy God. Payment is due for sin. So what he says here is, no, I'm going to satisfy that wrath. All right, the wrath of God is going to be satisfied against his people. Look at verse 11. It says, as a result of the anguish of his soul, he will see it. This is that guilt offering. He'll see it and be satisfied. In other words, God is going to look upon the offering of the Messiah, and all of that wrath that was supposed to fall to you, all that wrath that was supposed to fall to me, the payment for our sin that ultimately we would pay for after our death, all that fell on Jesus. And that wrath, that anger towards sin is now taken away because of him. He's a guilt offering. He takes away the wrath of God. It's a word we use is called propitiation. You ever heard that's a kind of the big Christian word? It means to appease the wrath of God. So that's the second thing that we get. And look at verse 12, and this is the last thing we're going to see. He takes away the sin of the people. He appeases the wrath of God. And this is really amazing. For those who trust in this guy, he brings reward. He brings reward. It says in verse 12, therefore, I will allot him a portion with the great. You know what? Many scholars look at that word great in the Hebrew, and it can be defined in multiple ways, but most guys see this as the great being the redeemed. The multitude of people who, because of this guy, now have life. And he's going to give this guy a portion, and you know what his portion is going to be? It's going to be us. We are the glory of the Lord. We are the glory of the Lord. Some days God's going to, we're going to stand around Christ, and this isn't going to be us on clouds with harps and halos playing like a Charmin commercial. That's not what it's going to be. And to be honest, it's not just going to be us standing in a big circle around Jesus in the center and we sing praises for millions of years. I can't tell you how many people believe that heaven is just going to be us standing around him singing all the time. I don't know about you, but I can sing for a little bit, but then I get done. right? We are going to be His glory. Do your children ever bring you glory in life? Do you see them and you go, ah, that's my son. Ah, that's my daughter. Ah, I love them. Look at what they've done for me. We now and forever will be the glory of the Lord, His portion. Keep going with me. And it says, and He will divide the booty with the strong. In other words, just like a general when they conquered a province or a people or an area, when they fought against the enemy and they won, you know what they did? They collected. They collected payment because of the war. Because of the fight, they're collecting money to pay this general who just gave up so much for all the families who gave up so much for the people who died in the war. They collect it. And you know what the general would do? He would take it and he would give it back to his people, to his generals. They would spread it out and all who fought got something. All who participated got something on the winning team. And that's what he's doing. He's dividing the booty with the strong. Can I just explain something? Christianity is not for the weak. Christianity is not for the weak. What's more difficult to do? What takes more strength? Pride or being humble? What's harder? What's easier? What's harder? Bitterness or compassion? What's more difficult? Justification for my sin, justifying what I've done, or confessing what I've done? See, the world system is set up so that we won't see Christ, that we'll want Him to be something because we're like water rolling downhill. We always want to roll to the easiest, lowest point. But Christ said, no, it's just not going to work that way. It's going to be counterintuitive to the world. I'm going to come, I'm going to die, and in dying, I'm going to bring life. And I'm going to set up a world to where if you trust in me, I will make you strong. Not if you bow up. Not if you follow the ways of the world. Not if you go to the easy path. But if you trust in me, which is so hard to do, I'm not going to make it just blindly easy. You're going to have faith. If you'll do that, I'll make you strong. So he divides the booty with the strong. Look at the rest of the text. Because he poured out himself to death and was numbered with the transgressors, yet he himself bore the sins of many and interceded for the transgressor. Praise God. See, the reason the world doesn't necessarily see Jesus as the Messiah is because God planned it that way. So the question for all of us is, as we leave this place, who do you see Jesus as? Do you see Jesus as some prophet, Elijah, John the Baptist, some good guy? Or is he truly the Messiah, the one who has the power to take away your sin and to give you everlasting life?